Hello, and welcome to the evening. I be Airman Bill Kenny, and you, as always, may be whomever you wish to be, as we join our recent arrival in studio, Mr. Peter Gabriel, on a Wednesday evening Nightside. As I mentioned at the start of our show, our very special in-studio guest this evening is Peter Gabriel, and if you haven't yet believed the fact that he is here from the strength of what we've already played, I assure you Peter is here tonight, and welcome to Nightside, Peter, and welcome to AFN.
Thank you very much.
And let's kind of jump right into the fray, if we can, a bit.
Fine.
The variety of the material on your first two albums is staggering, to say the least. What kind of motivation enables you to write Modern Love, and then at a period later turn around and write DIY? Except that they're by the same person, you can't say they sound the same or they go in the same direction. How do you write the type of material you do write?
I think I'm attracted to variety. I think you get probably two types of musician, one who likes to become a specialist, and one field and is well known for that, and others who are generalist. And I think I fit better into that category. Also, I would class myself as a writer rather than a musician, so that a writer would like to use different styles to interpret his songs, as opposed to a musician who perhaps is well known for one particular style. So it's just really the things that interest me.
Now, you mentioned that you consider yourself more as a writer, so that the performing end for you, could that end tomorrow and you would still be satisfied, or do you enjoy putting your tunes down and then putting them across live?
Well, it's interesting, at the time I left Genesis in 74, well actually 75 by the time I was announced, but I thought at that time I was going to get out of the business and stop performing and function perhaps still as a writer, but not necessarily performing my own songs. Then, after a period, I became interested in seeing the songs arranged and sounding the way that I wanted. Therefore, I ended up recording them myself, and then I got to performing them. And I think I would miss that a lot if I were to stop it now, because it's a really good direct means of assessing how people react to your music. And I'm also trying to play stuff a little before I record it, because sometimes you get a feel when you actually have to throw all your energy into a number and there's no takes that you can fall back on. That sometimes a character develops for the number which might not come out in the studio.
Association, which for a large number of people, of course, is Peter Gabriel of Genesis. And I want to talk a minute, at least, about when you were fronting Genesis as the vocalist in there. There were, you know, bewildering costume changes, stage presentations, and yet by contrast, the 1978 edition model of Peter Gabriel is a very streamlined, not strict,
straight man,
but streamlined model of a singer and an act. Why the change? There's the music, you're almost pushing the music to stand on its own merits. No fancy stage show as such.
Yeah, well, that's exactly the point. That, I think it would have been quite easy for me to come through strong in a visual sense. And that would have been harder for me then to get some form of credibility on a musical, particularly songwriting basis, which I think I needed to establish at this point in my own right, as it were. So I'm still very interested in a lot of visual things, and I'm hoping to work next year on videotape, video disc projects. And definitely I still am attracted to odd-looking and odd-sounding things. But I just felt that the initial thrust must be on a sort of straight musical level, and then I'm almost getting to the point now where I feel I've got a separate identity, solid, so that perhaps I'll begin playing about with some visual things.
When you first left Genesis and then became a solo artist, you don't do it now, but did you have to when you first started, talking about the definition of a separate identity? Did you discover people were going and they would put up with Peter Gabriel and your material for a certain extent, but then they wanted to see you do some of the Genesis material? And how did you deal with that?
Sure, well, obviously there was quite a lot of interest from old Genesis people. I think that the first point was, it was over 2 years since I left Genesis before I actually reappeared in live performance, so to some extent some of that interest had been eroded and I was beginning again. But the way I played it was that to do no Genesis material at all in my stage act, and then if people would give me an encore based on new stuff, then I was prepared to indulge in a little nostalgia for them. So that's the way it's been, and I think that's worked out fine.
Switching completely now from the live aspect. This is funny on the radio because you can't see the record cover, but I want to talk about your album covers for the first two in an interface with how you come across. The first album has a man who's been in Genesis for years, he's now on his own, Peter Gabriel, and you would assume with that kind of prior association there'd be a big picture of Peter Gabriel on the cover, and there is, kinda, sorta. You're shot through a windscreen, covered in rain. Second album has you more or less tearing the cover, and we can almost see a bit more of Peter Gabriel, even though this time he again calls his album just Peter Gabriel. And right after the album is released, you go through a haircut change so that you no longer resemble physically anyone who could have figured out what that was on the album. Percy Shelley, I believe it was, said the purpose of art is to conceal art. Is the purpose of Peter Gabriel's album covers to conceal Peter Gabriel?
No, I don't think so. I think the main purpose there is to come up with an interesting looking visual image that is that appeals to me for the mood it creates, rather than for the power it has in generating me a new image. And I also didn't want to be associated with a hard sell. You know, I wanted to feel that I was starting again as a new artist, rather than coming in with all barrels open, using old associations. So there was that feeling. Also, the use of the name and no title was to give it an atmosphere of a magazine that comes out once a year. That's like a Time or a Newsweek, where you get to see the logo in the same place every time, and you recognize the different editions by the picture on the front, not by the title. And there was the idea, too, that often bands try and market each album as something new, sensationally exciting, and different from anything that they've done before, when often they sound remarkably similar. So I thought I would do the opposite of that and come up with something that looked remarkably similar.
With miracle ingredient Z247 and such.
Right.
cutting out all that from my jungle tape. Anyone at all? Can't you see no? He's better than the hero standing by on call. Oh, it's not easy. No, 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 no. No, it's not easy making real friends.
Peter Gabriel fans then expect the next issue of the Peter Gabriel News Weekly?
Actually, probably not for a while. Probably September. I've got some little bits recorded, and I'll be recording some next over next year, but there are a few other projects that are less, that will keep me out of the record tour rut, which a lot of artists fall into. Which I think are important for me to explore.
So it'll be like September of 79 then, before you begin?
Yeah. It's possible it may be out before, but the summer is always a dodgy time to bring out albums. This last one was brought out in the summertime, and people were... It's the lowest point in the record market. Record companies don't like putting stuff out there.
Yeah, it's bad for consumer sales. Right. Everybody goes away for the summer,
right.
And the album collects dust on shelves.
Yeah.
I talked about this earlier, about how you what motivates you to write tunes, and you were just mentioning you get bits and pieces. In the next album that comes up, I'm curious as to how you write material, specifically in the sense of off the Peter Gabriel album. How's that for being safe?
Fine. Yeah.
Home Sweet Home.
Yeah.
Which is a cheerfully cynical song, if I've ever heard one.
Yeah.
What motivated you to write a tune like that, that's so cute, until you really think about what you're saying?
Yeah. Well, the story, there was a news item of a mother who was so depressed in a high-rise apartment that she eventually jumped out with her kid, and that was splashed on the front pages of the popular dailies, and it had a lot more sort of emotional impact than a lot of other sort of war descriptions or anything else. So that sort of stuck home. And then I used that as a starting point for a fictional story of a fortune, sort of a young married couple, and set it against it. I know the influences in the arrangement are supposed to be a slightly odd mixture of some electronic the sounds and some almost sort of country and western from a steel guitar, so that you have the sense of a story being told and something going wrong.
Do you have? They don't. I can't get a handle on anything you might have listened to earlier from listening to the two albums at all. It's so varied.
I think probably all sorts of things have influenced me. I think often what one does is over the years you just sort of register the things that you like that really hit strong, and then they blend and mix, and then are spewed out the other end. With perhaps your own personality coming through. Initially, what excited me in music, I think, was some soul, blues things in the 60s. Otis Redding, I used to love, well, still do. Nina Simone. Then a lot of the British bands, the Beatles, Stones, Kinks, Who, Yardbirds, Small Faces. And, all those bands, I think, were the sort of the excitement of my teenage years, and I identified with them strongly. And then perhaps some of the more melodic things, backrack Beach Boys, Beatles will fall into that as well. Perhaps some old style writers there, and maybe bits of classical things, which my family would play quite a lot, which I think I must have subconsciously absorbed. And also hymns from being at school, some of which I used to enjoy a lot. And one of which is called "Come My Way," which sounds all set for a porno pistache, but is one of my favourite hymns actually, and I'm thinking of recording it.
We talked a bit about your influences, what you listened to as you were growing up and evolving. I've been told that among your favorites now, and it's a mutual admiration society in a sense, you are very high on certain new wave bands, and they appear to reciprocate as such. What is there about new wave at all that intrigues your ear?
I don't think all would get into my stuff, but I've always been interested in progressive music. And progressive music now is often attached as a label to some of the older bands in the 60s, who in some cases have stopped exploring avenues and have adopted styles which they don't move from. Yet some of the, at the ground floor level, some of the new bands have perhaps the opportunity, because they are new and don't have a fixed identity, to explore things and perhaps have more right to the label progressive now at this point. There's also within punk a lot of formula music too, and formula music is the thing that bores me after a while, although I think the energy of some of the new bands is very good, and a turnaround in the music business every few years is very healthy, because it means that it wipes off the map anyone who isn't appealing strongly to an audience. And I like that sort of competition.
Going back as far as you do within the music industry as such, did you find it amusing, say a year or a year and a half ago, when the British trades were discovering punk, when they were walking around and announcing that they were beginning things, they were discovering things? A lot of people I've talked to who came out of bands from the mid-60s and early 70s kind of smile and say, well, we thought we were very revolutionary also. Yeah. When we found the first three chords that they're using now.
Sure. No, I mean, I think there is some of that, but there is also a style tied up with it, and I think each generation likes to have a style and identity which will antagonize the previous generation. For instance, I didn't get into Elvis Presley, I didn't get into a lot of the old rock and roll people, because my elder cousins were thrusting it down my throat, and I could play my Beatles and Stones records very loud, which at that time, you know, they thought, well, rubbish. So I think there's some of that which is just course of nature. Thank you.
professionals are gonna be a man. We're gonna have a romantic album, anything you can. I'm telling the professionals, I wanna be a man. If I wave my wand, watch the lightning disappear.
People who go to see you can probably answer this better, perhaps, than you, but they're not here tonight. Why do you think people go to see you perform live? And are they the same people who buy your albums, or is it a different fragment of that audience?
They come see me live because they've been drinking the water, which is certain illicit substances. Now, I think it's mainly in the music. I think I'm still interested in melody to some extent, or to a large extent, and also with trying different things out, so that there is a chance that something might happen at one of my shows that they might not have seen elsewhere. It's always hard to say. I think people come for different things.
Looking back over the ages, as it were, if you had anything to do over, would you do it over? Do you have any regrets at all over the way your career has progressed?
No, like Charles Aznavour, I regret nothing.
You mentioned a late summer, early next fall excursion into the studios with the Christmas holidays. Willie Wilson, home of Barclay James Harvest, said everyone likes to spend Christmas at home.
That's right.
So I'm assuming that's what's in store, hopefully, for you. I wish you that.
Yeah, I work on Christmas Eve, though. Yes, anyway.
What after that, between the holidays and going to the studio?
Things to do, yeah, and next year. There's a few projects which I have in mind. One is video, which I mentioned before. I've always been interested in the possibility of matching up visual things and music, and I think Devo are an example of a band who are doing that in an interesting way now, and will be the video disc being about to be launched, and by the company, which happens to be my European record label. I have to find some sponsorship there. At least it's being discussed now. So I want to be doing some of that, and there's a project too to try and get a tour on a train, which has been a fantasy for a while. The idea there being that instead of putting everything up and down each night, you would travel the whole thing, and the back line of the instruments would be set up in a carriage. One side of the carriage would drop down. This would extend out to be the front of the stage. And the lighting rig would also extend out of the roof of the carriage. And the PA would be set in the carriages either side, so that you could literally drive into a concert situation, play your show, and then drive off again. The problems, obviously, are where you play. So at the moment, we're investigating old mining sites, railway sheds. Already, I think, in Cologne, there's a TV studio in an old railway shed. In England, there's the Roundhouse, for instance, which used to be a railway shed, too. It may just be a summertime thing, and I don't know that I can do it, but I'm quite excited about the possibility of it. Also, the other thing that it might enable me to do would be to reach places that wouldn't normally get to see concerts, and that's something that I would like to do, because often it's much more rewarding sometimes to play in places where people are starved in music. Partly because they're really enthusiastic, and also because the rapport and the relationship between artists and the audience is sort of much stronger. And also just make it a tour more interesting.
But you won't be able to sneak out without getting an encore if you do that. You realize
that. Right, yes. But Mickey Mouse is doing all right with his whistle stop tour. So it's an inspiration to me at the moment.
Thank you very much, Peter, for coming by and
great.
Spending the time with us.
Thanks a lot.
I'm here to go, baby, you got it, you know, please.
you, Gabriel. Modern love can be such a strain. I guess life on the road also. If you didn't get out to Frankfurt tonight to the Jahrhundert Halle, do not feel too bad about it. You'll be in Munich tomorrow night. There are a sizable number of tickets still left. I don't know how many. I didn't get a chance to actually get into numbers on the phone. Mannheim is Friday night. You've got the last date Friday night, Mannheim, so listen up and listen in. And there aren't a whole lot of tickets available for that. They will probably be scarce as hen's teeth, to hackney a cliche to death again. Ah, yes, I checked on the way out. There is still a roof left on the Jahrhundert Halle, though we tried very hard tonight to tear it off, and phenomenal, and as I said when we left, I said thank you very much to Peter, but I have to again thank Thomas Kvast. If Moses could find manna in the desert, then Thomas can find taxicabs at the Jahrhundert Halle. We got out about 20 minutes to 11 and went, holy Mary, manna da 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 da. And zippity-doo-dah, there was a cab. And Thomas, again, thank you ever so much for bringing Peter by. And thank you, Peter, for being Peter.
Well, thank you very much. Now I think it's time for us all to go. So from all of us to all of you, not forgetting the boys in the band and our producer, Reg Thorpe, would like to say, God bless. So, if you're out tonight, don't forget, if you're on your bike, wear white.
And good evening to you, Mick. And to you, a good night. Also to you, Peter and Tom. We'll see you back here at the same space and time tomorrow. Till then, take care, be good, stay well.